శ్రీ భగవాన్ ఉవాచ, అభయం సత్వ సంశుద్ధి జ్ఞాన యోగ వ్యవస్థితి దానం దామశ్చ యజ్ఞశ్చ స్వధ్యాయస్తప అర్జవం అహింస సత్యం అక్రోధ త్యాగ శాంతిర్ అపైశునాం దయాభూతేష్ అలోలోపత్వం మార్దవం హ్రీ చ అచ ఫలం తేజ క్షేమం ధృతి శౌచం అద్రోహో నతి మానిత భవంతి సంపదం దైవీం అభిజతాస్య భారత. ద సుప్రీం పర్సనాలిటీ ఆఫ్ గాడ్ హెడ్ సెడ్, అభయం ఫియర్లెస్నెస్, సత్వం సంశుద్ధి ప్యూరిఫికేషన్ ఆఫ్ వన్స్ ఎగ్జిస్టెన్స్, జ్ఞానం ఇన్ నాలెడ్జ్, యోగా ఆఫ్ లింకింగ్ అప్, వ్యవస్థితి ద సిచ్యువేషన్, దానం చారిటీ, దానం కంట్రోలింగ్ ద మైండ్ చ, అండ్ యజ్ఞ పర్ఫార్మెన్స్ ఆఫ్ సాక్రిఫైస్ చ, అండ్ స్వధ్యాయ స్టడీ ఆఫ్ ద వేదిక్ లిటరేచర్, తప ఆస్టెరిటీ, ఆర్జవం సింప్లిసిటీ, అహింస నాన్ వైలెన్స్, సత్యం ట్రూత్ఫుల్నెస్, అక్రోధ ఫ్రీడమ్ ఫ్రమ్ యాంగర్, త్యాగ రినౌన్సియేషన్, శాంతి ట్రాంక్విలిటీ, అపైశునం వర్షన్ టు ఫాల్ట్ ఫైండింగ్, దయా మర్సీ భూతేషు టువర్డ్స్ ఆల్ లివింగ్ ఎంటిటీస్, అలోలుత్వం ఫ్రీడమ్ ఫ్రమ్ గ్రీడ్, మార్దవం జెంటల్నెస్, రిహి మోడెస్టీ, అచాపలం డిటర్మినేషన్, తేజ విగర్, క్షేమం ఫర్గివ్నెస్, ధృతి ఫోర్టిట్యూడ్, శౌచం క్లీన్లీనెస్, అద్రోహ ఫ్రీడమ్ ఫ్రమ్ ఎన్వీ నా నాన్ అతి ఎక్స్పెక్టేషన్ ఆఫ్ ఆనర్ భవంతి సంపదం qualities diving the transcendental nature avijata asya one who is born of bharata, o son of bharata. Translation: the supreme personality of god had said, fearlessness, purification of one existence, cultivation of spiritual knowledge, charity, self control, performance of sacrifice, study of the vedas, austerity, simplicity, non violence, truthfulness, freedom from anger, renunciation, tranquility, aversion to fault finding, compassion for all living entities, freedom from covetousness, gentleness, modesty, steady vigor, forgiveness, fortitude, cleanliness, and freedom from envy and from the passion for honor. These transcendental qualities, O son of Bharata, belong to godly men endowed with divine nature. Supported by divine grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. In the beginning of the 15th chapter, the banyan tree of this material world was explained. The extra roots coming out of it were compared to the activities of living entities, some auspicious, some inauspicious. In the 9th chapter also, the devas are godly and the asuras, the ungodly or demons, were explained. Now, according to the Vedic rites, activities in the mode of goodness are considered auspicious for progress on the path of liberation. And such activities are known as devi or prakriti, transcendental by nature. Those who are situated in the transcendental nature make progress on the path of liberation. For those who are acting in the mode of passion and ignorance, on the other hand, there is no possibility of liberation. Either they will have to remain in this material world as human beings, or they will descend among the species of animals or even lower life forms. In the 16th chapter, the Lord explains both the transcendental nature and its attendant qualities, and the demonic nature and its qualities. He also explained the advantages and disadvantages of these qualities. The word abhijatasya, in reference to one born of transcendental qualities or godly tendencies, is very significant. To beget a child in godly atmosphere is known in Vedic scripture as garbhadhana samskara. If the parent wants a child in godly quality, they should follow the 10 principles recommended for the social life of human being. In the Bhagavad Gita, we have studied also before that sex life is for getting good child is Krishna himself. Sex life is not recommended provided the process is used in Krishna consciousness. Those who are in Krishna consciousness, that they should not beget children like cats and dogs, but should beget them so that they may become Krishna conscious after birth. That should be the advantage children born of a father and mother absorb in Krishna consciousness. The social institution known as Varnashram Dharma, the institution are dividing society into four divisions of social life and four occupational divisions or caste is not meant to divide human society according to birth. Such divisions are in terms of educational qualification. They are to keep the society in a state of peace and prosperity. The qualities mentioned herein are explained as transcendental qualities meant for making a person progressive in spiritual understanding so that he can get liberated from the material world. In the Varnashram institution, the sannyasi, the person in the renounced order of life, is considered to be the head or the spiritual master of the social status and order. A brahmana is considered to be a spiritual master of the three other sections of the society, namely the kshatriyas, the vaishyas, and the sudras. But a sannyasi is on top of the institution, is considered the spiritual master of the brahmanas also. For sannyasi, the first qualification should be fearlessness. Because a sannyasi has to be alone without any support, a guarantee of support is simply to depend on the mercy of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. If one thinks after I leave my connection, who will protect me, he should not accept the renounced order of life. One must be fully convinced that Krishna or the Supreme Personality of Godhead in his localized aspect as Paramatma is always within. That is seeing everything and he always knows what one intends to do. One must thus have firm conviction that Krishna as Paramatma will take care of a soul surrendered to him. I shall never be alone. One should think, even if I live in the darkest region of the forest, I shall be accompanied by Krishna and he will give me all protection. This conviction is called abhayam, fearlessness. This state of mind is necessary for a person in the renounced order of life. Then he has to purify his existence. There are so many rules and regulations to be followed in the renounced order of life. Most important of all, a sannyasi is strictly forbidden to have any intimate relationship with women. He is even forbidden to talk with women in a secluded place. Lord Chaitanya was an ideal sannyasi, and when he was at Puri, his feminine devotees could not even come near to offer their respects. They were advised to bow down from a distant place. It's not a sign of hatred for women as a class, but it's a scripture imposed on the sannyasi not to have close connection with women. One has to follow the rules and regulations of a particular status of life in order to purify his existence. For sannyasi, intimate relation with women and possession of wealth for sanctification are strictly forbidden. Ideal sannyasi was Lord Chaitanya himself, and we can learn from his life that he was very strict in regard to women. Although he is considered to be the most liberal incarnation of Godhead, accepting the most fallen conditioned soul, he strictly followed the rules and regulations of sannyasa, orders of life in connection with the association with women. One of his personal associates, namely Chota Haridas, was associated with Lord Chaitanya along with other confidential personal associates. But somehow or other, this Chota Haridas looked lustfully on a young woman and Lord Chaitanya was so strict that he at once rejected him from the society of personal associates. Lord Chaitanya said, for sannyasi, anyone who is aspiring to get out of the clutches of material nature and trying to elevate himself to the spiritual nature and go back home, back to Godhead, for him looking toward material possession and women for sense gratification, not even enjoying them, but just looking toward them with such a propensity, so condemned that he had better commit suicide before experiencing such illicit desires. But these are the processes for purification. In the next item is Jnana Yoga Vyavastitihi. Been engaged in the cultivation of knowledge. Sannyasi life is meant for distributing knowledge to the householders and others who have forgotten their real life for spiritual advancement. A sannyasi is supposed to beg from door to door for his livelihood, but this does not mean that he is a beggar. Humility is also one of the qualifications of a transcendentally situated person. And out of sheer humility, the sannyasi goes from door to door, not exactly for the purpose of begging, but to see the householders and awaken them to Krishna consciousness. This is the duty of a sannyasi. He was actually advanced, so ordered by his spiritual master, he should preach Krishna consciousness with logic and understanding. And if one is not so advanced, he should not accept the renounced order of life. But even if one has accepted the renounced order of life without sufficient knowledge, he should engage himself fully in hearing from a bona fide spiritual master to cultivate knowledge. A sannyasi or one in the renounced order of life must be situated in fearlessness, sattva, samsudhi, purity, and jnana yoga, knowledge. The next item is charity. Charity is meant for the householders. householder should earn a livelihood by an honorable means and spend 50% of the income to propagate Krishna consciousness all over the world. Thus, a householder should give in charity to constitutional society that are engaged in that way. Charity should be given to the right receiver. There are different kinds of charity as will be explained later on. Charity in the modes of goodness, passion and ignorance. Charity in the mode of goodness is recommended by the scriptures. But charity in the mode of passion and ignorance is not recommended because it is simply waste of money. Charity should be given only to propagate Krishna consciousness all over the world. There is charity in the mode of goodness. Then as far as Dharma, self-control is concerned, it's only meant for other orders of religious society, but it's specially meant for the householders. Although he has a wife, a householder should not use his sense for sex life unnecessarily. There are restrictions for householders even in sex life, which should only be engaged in for propagation of children. If he does not require children, he should not enjoy sex life with his wife. Modern society enjoys sex life with contraceptive methods, a more abominable method to avoid the responsibility of children. This is not in the transcendental quality, but is demonic. If anyone, even if he is a householder, wants to make progress in spiritual life, he must control his sex life and should not beget a child without the purpose of serving Krishna. If he is able to beget children who will be in Krishna consciousness, one can produce hundreds of children. But without this capacity, one should not indulge only for sense pleasure. Sacrifice is another item to be performed by the householder because sacrifice requires a large amount of money. Those in other orders of life, namely brahmachari, vanaprastha and sannyasa, have no money. They live by begging. The performance of different types of sacrifices meant for the householders. They should perform agnihotra sacrifices enjoined in the Vedic literature. But such sacrifices at the present moment are very expensive and it is not possible for any householder to perform them. The best sacrifice recommended in this age is called the Sankirtan Yajna. The Sankirtan Yajna, the chanting of Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, is the best and most inexpensive sacrifice. Everyone can adopt it and derive benefit. So these three items, namely charity, sense control and performance sacrifice, are meant for householders. The Swadaya Vedic study is meant for brahmachari or student life. Brahmachari should have no connection with women. They should live a life of celibacy and engage the mind in the study of the Vedic literature for cultivation of spiritual knowledge. This is called Swadaya. Tapas austerity is meant for the retired life. One should not remain a householder throughout his life. He must always remember that there are four divisions of life, brahmacharya, grahastha, vanaprastha and sannyas. So after grahastha, householder life, one should retire. If one lives for 100 years, he should spend 25 years in student life, 25 in householder life, 25 in retired life and 25 in renowned sort of life. They are all regulations of Vedic religious discipline. A man retired from household life must practice austerities of the body, mind and tongue. That is tapasya. The entire varnashram, dharma, society is meant for tapasya. Without tapasya, austerity, no human being can get liberation. The theory that there is no need of austerity in life, that one can go on speculating and everything will be nice, is recommended neither in the Vedic literature nor in the Bhagavad Gita. Such theories are manufactured by show bottle spiritualists who are trying to gather more followers. If there are restrictions, rules and regulations, people will not become attractive. Therefore, those who want to want followers in the name of religion must have, just to have a show only, don't restrict the lives of the student nor their own lives. But that method is not approved by the Vedas. As far as Brahminical quality of simplicity is concerned, not only should a particular order of life follow the principle, but every member to be he in the brahmachari ashram, grahastha ashram, vanaprastha ashram, sannyasa ashram, one should be very simple and straightforward. Ahimsa means not arresting the progressive life of any living entity. One should not think that since the spirit spark is never killed, even after killing of the body, there is no harm in killing animals for sense gratification. People are now addicted to eating animals in spite of having an ample supply of grains, fruits and milk. There is no necessity for killing animals. This injunction is for everyone. When there is no alternative, One may kill an animal, but it should be offered in sacrifice. At any rate, when there is an ample food supply for humanity, persons who are designed to make advancement in spiritual realization should not commit violence to animals. Real ahimsa means not checking anyone's progressive life. The animals are also making progress in their evolutionary life by transmigrating from one category of animal life to another. If a particular animal is killed, then its progress is checked. If an animal is staying in a particular body for so many days or so many years and untimely killed, then he has to come back again in that form of life to complete the remaining days in order to be promoted to another species of life. This progress should not be checked simply to satisfy one's talent. This is called ahimsa. Satyam. The word satyam means that one should not distort the truth for some personal interests. In Vedic literature, there are some difficult passages, but the meaning of the purpose should be learned from a bona fide spiritual master. That is the process of understanding the Vedas. Shruti means that one should hear from the authority. One should not construe some interpretation for his personal interests. There are so many commentaries on the Bhagavad Gita that misinterpret the original text. The real import of the word should be presented, and that should be learned from a bona fide spiritual master. Akrodha means to check anger. Even if there is a provocation, one should be tolerant. From once one becomes angry, his whole body becomes polluted. Anger is product of the mode of passion and lust. So one who is transcendentally situated should check himself from anger. Apaisuna means one should not find fault with others or correct them unnecessarily. Of course, to call a thief is not fault-finding, but to call an honest person a thief is very much offensive for one who is making advancement in spiritual life. Re means that one should be modest and must not perform some act which is abominable. Achapalam, determination, means that one should not be agitated or frustrated in some attempt. There may be failure in some attempt, but one should not be worried for that. He should make progress with patience and determination. The word tejas used here is meant for the kshatriya. The kshatriya should always be very strong, be able to give protection to the weak. They should not pose themselves as violent. If violence is required, they must exhibit it. But a person who is able to curb down his enemy may, under certain conditions, show forgiveness. He may excuse minor offenses. Saucham means cleanliness, not only in mind and body, but in one's dealing also. Especially meant for the mercantile people who should not deal in the black market. Nati manita, not expecting honor, applies to the sudras, the worker class, which are considered, according to Vedic injunction, to be the lowest of the four classes. They should not be puffed up with unnecessary prestige or honor and should remain in their own status. It is the duty of the sudras to offer respect to the higher class for the upkeep of social order. All these 26 qualifications mentioned are transcendental qualities. They should be cultivated according to the different status of social and occupational duty. The purport is that even though material conditions are miserable, if these qualities are developed by practice by all classes of men, then gradually it is possible to rise to the highest platform of transcendental realization. So, chapter 16, text 1 to 3, Krishna is given a list of transcendental qualities. These transcendental qualities come by being in the mode of goodness. These qualities are acquired by when the mind becomes purified, you know, by associating in the mode of goodness. This is explained here. You can see, we are give you an answer. In the Supreme Personality of Godhead said the three modes of material nature, namely goodness, passion and ignorance, pertain to material intelligence and not to the spirit soul. By development of material goodness, one can conquer the modes of passion and ignorance, and by cultivation of transcendental goodness, one may free oneself even from material goodness. So now try to understand how we can get all these good qualities. You understand? So I want to show you what is the good qualities further. We have read it now. Again, Krishna is also saying this. Again, Krishna is saying all the good qualities that come from goodness. See? Mind and sense control, tolerance, discrimination, sticking to one's prescribed duty, fruitfulness, mercy, careful study of the past and future, satisfaction in any condition, generosity, renunciation of sense gratification, faith in spiritual master, being embarrassed at improper action, charity, simplicity, humbleness, and satisfaction within oneself are qualities in the mode of goodness. So you see here, these are all the mode of goodness. See? So again, Krishna also saying, so mode of goodness means, you see, very good quality, mind and sense control, tolerance, discriminating, sticking to one's prescribed duty, fruitfulness, mercy, careful study of the past and future, satisfaction in any condition, generosity, renunciation of sense gratification, faith in the spiritual master, being embarrassed at improper action, charity, simplicity, humbleness, and satisfaction within oneself, qualities in the mode of goodness. In fact, Krishna is saying these are qualities in the mode of, it is the qualities of those who are divine. Now you see how you go to the bad qualities. So that's why Krishna says you don't go to the mode of passion and ignorance. Why? If you go there, you will develop these qualities. You see here, I'm going to highlight this. Material desire, great endeavor, audacity, dissatisfaction even in gain, false pride, praying for a material advancement, considering oneself different and better than others, sense gratification, rash eagerness to fight, a fondness for hearing oneself praised, the tendency to ridicule others, advertising one's prowess, and justifying one's action by one's strength or qualities of the mode of passion. You see this point? So these are the bad qualities will develop. First is material desire. Material desire comes from the mode of passion. And great endeavor, working so hard for some nonsense. Audacity, full of audacity, proud, very proud. You know, dissatisfaction even in gain. Even how much you get, also more greed comes in. False pride, always proud, you know, never listen to anybody, hankar, praying for material advancement, always give me this, give me that, give me this, give me that, unlimited, considering oneself different and better than, this is another quality, thinking oneself always, I'm the best, I know better, nobody knows, I know better, and sense gratification means always want to enjoy the senses. And then rash eagerness to fight. At a little moment you want to fight. Everything quarreling, fighting, quarreling. And then not only that, a fondness of hearing oneself praised. Oh, I am champion, I am very good, I'm best, you know. People say something, I want to know how good they are, you know. The tendency to ridicule others. This is the condescending behavior. Everybody is rascal, you rascal, always chastising others. This is another bad quality. Advertising one's progress and justifying one action by one's strength or qualities in the mode of life. Every time, how I'm so good, I did this, I did that, because of me only this happened. You see, all these are qualities in the mode of passion and that we see abundantly being practiced actually. This quality is so numerous, everybody, you know. Then we're going now to the mode of ignorance. I mean, ignorance. You see the ignorance quality. Intolerant anger. Stinginess. Don't want to give any money. Always, you know, keeping, trying to take anything for themselves. Speaking without scriptural authority. No shastra. Violent hatred. They hate everybody. living as a parasite, how to make use of others, hypocrisy, a hypocrite, chronic fatigue, always tired, sick, lazy, quarreling, lamentation, delusion, unhappiness, depression, sleeping too much, false expectation, fear and laziness constitute the major qualities of the modes of the person. You understand now? Please hear about the combination of the three modes. So you see, so we have given you an idea what is goodness, what is passion, and what is ignorance. So now, how to purify ourselves? That is the whole idea, you know, how to do that. So here Krishna is saying further, you know, if you go to this mode, when consciousness is fixed on the material body, home and other similar objects of sense gratification, one spends one's life chasing after material objects with the help of the senses. Consciousness, thus powerfully affected by the mode of passion, becomes dedicated to impermanent things, and in this way, irreligion, ignorance, attachment, and wretchedness arise. You see, all this thing comes about by this program. What program is that? By becoming fixed in a material body, concentrating only on the house. I mean, house means wife, children, family, this is all only. And then always interested in enjoying the senses. Understand? Or chasing after material object with the help of the sense. One to get this. That means last and greed, no? Last, greed, and anger. Ichcha, divisi, samutena, hating, liking, this, that. So you see how this consciousness will bring about irreligion, ignorance, attachment, and wretchedness. Bad qualities are coming. So to counteract these bad qualities, therefore, it is explained. So it conquer that one by developing the material goodness. You see this here? Because the soul has nothing to do with this. The soul has got nothing to do with this body. Because of the attachment of the body, you know, all this is coming out. Yeah, this is the biggest problem, you know. When we start thinking that I am this body, then many, many problems start, you know. As also further explained by Narada, you know, in this verse. Right, see here. The living entity by nature has minute independence to choose his own good or bad fortune. When he forgets his supreme master, the personality of Godhead, he gives himself up to the modes of nature. By being influenced by the modes of nature, he identifies himself with the body, and for the interest of the body, he becomes attached to various activities. Sometimes under the influence of mode of ignorance, sometimes mode of passion, sometimes in the mode of goodness. The living entity thus gets different types of body under the modes of nature. So he gets different kinds of body, you know. Those are situated in the mode of goodness, act piously according to Vedic injunction, thus they elevate to higher planetary system where the demigods live. Those influenced by the mode of passion engage in various types of productive activities in the planet system where human beings live. Similarly, those influenced by the mode of darkness are subject to various types of misery and live in the animal kingdom. So he said, this is the situation. So we are now stuck. So So our whole idea is to get out of this mess, develop the good qualities. We want to develop the good qualities, you know. So by cultivating the mode of goodness, right, as we explained, see, when the living energy becomes strongly situated in mode of goodness, then religious principles characterized by devotional service to me become prominent. One can strengthen the mode of goodness by cultivation of these things that are already situated in goodness. That's religious principle, right? That's why we are asking everybody to, you know, practice this Krishna consciousness. Because by coming at least to the mode of goodness, then everything will start. Then all good qualities will start. Slowly, slowly everything will, you know, it says here. Religious principles strengthened by the mode of goodness destroy the influence of passion and ignorance. You see that? That this is very important. Yeah. Destroy the influence of passion and ignorance. When passion and ignorance are overcome, the original cause, irreligion, is quickly vanquished. You see? When passion and ignorance are overcome, then original cause, irreligion, is quickly. This is the biggest enemy for us. Although we may not understand this fully, but this influence of our mind, you know, this bad quality, fault finding, insulting, you know, becoming proud, thinking I'm the best man around, all these things are in our heart. Disease, lust, anger, greed, all coupled already. So when we want to clean this up, that's why we must come to the mode of goodness. A mode of goodness means waking up in the morning and chanting Krishna name. This is very important, especially before sunrise. If someone does not want to do this, then he can be chanting for years and years and years, but he will never come to the mode of goodness. Pure goodness. You will never. You see this point? You will not. It's difficult for them. In fact, if he carries on in this lax manner, then there's a good chance he will fall down. You know why? Because if the senses and the mind are not controlled, well, if we engage in the mode of passion and ignorance, then it's explained here, you see what happens. The illusory material nature attracts the minute living energy to embrace her. And as a result, you assume form composed of a quality. And you see this word? This is very important, this point. Subsequently, he loses all his spiritual qualities and must undergo repeated death. So you understand, he may be chanting and may everything, but he does not become strong in trying to become serious, then he will lose all his spiritual qualities. Although he may say, oh, Prabhu, what I've done is all my gain. Yeah, that gain is there. We don't say no. That may be, you know, you'll be brought to the heavenly world where you enjoy, and then when you finish, you come back again and start again where you left off. But here, now we are talking about how to become strong devotee. That we are, our point is to be a strong devotee. So if it becomes devotee means if we don't follow, then we will also get the bad qualities. Understand, it doesn't mean that you chanting me, you will never get any bad. No. You see here, he loses. Subsequently, he loses his spiritual quality and must undergo repeat birth and death. Further explained here, in another verse, you can see. I think it's 40, sorry, a mistake. 16. Let me see, I may be. Yes. A transcendentalist who does not completely control his words and mind by superior intelligence will find that his spiritual vows, austerity and charity will flow away just as water flows out of an unbaked clay pot. So it is the problem, you know, sometimes we've seen devotees, you know, they slip away. Why? Because they don't control their words and the mind. Then they don't have good association. They take their spiritual discipline in a lax way. As he says, sahaja, take it easy. And what happens? Everything goes. See that? His word and mind are not controlled by superior intelligence. Will find his spiritual vows, austerity and charity will flow away just as water flows out of unbaked clay pot. You understand, clay pot must be baked, then it's hard, then you can keep water. If you don't bake it, you just keep water, the water will seep out from the mud. Finish. You understand? So we cannot, you know, think that, oh, I'm chanting, I'm safe. Yes, you're safe. But if you don't strictly follow the discipline given by the spiritual master, then how are you going to become strong? How are you going to become strong? This is not some joke, you know. Maya is not a joke. She's always on us, lurking on us. You understand? It's also explained, you know, in this another verse. Give me a minute. I just get it for you. That how a person may have so much knowledge. You will have so much knowledge. And then he thinks that, yes, I know everything. He thinks that he knows everything, but he does not want to practice. Then actually it is said, you can see here, because of greed for the sake of the senses, the spiritual strength, education, austerity and reputation of a devotee or brahmana who is not self-satisfied dwindles and his knowledge gradually vanishes. This constitutes of a fall down. It constitutes of a fall down. So you see, that's why for the householders, it is very strongly recommended. This was a question asked by Yudhishthira Maharaj. We householders, what shall we do? How to do it? Maharaj Yudhishthira inquired from Narada Muni, O my Lord, O great sage, kindly explain how we who are staying at home without knowledge of the goal of life may also easily attain liberation according to the instruction of the Veda. See how? That honest question, Yudhishthira is what? Raja Rishi is not some ordinary person, you know. He's so close with Krishna. Asking a very practical question, you know. So in this, the Narada watcher is saying, Narada Muni replied, my dear king, those who stay at home as householders must act to earn their livelihood. And instead of trying to enjoy the result of their work themselves, they should offer this result to Krishna, Vasudev. How to satisfy Vasudev in this life can be perfectly understood through the association of great devotees of the Lord. See that point? Are we all working as householders? Naturally, we have to make some money. And naturally, when we make some money, we want to enjoy them also, correct? So therefore, we should learn how to offer the result to Krishna. How to do that? We must learn through the association of great devotees of the Lord. Right? See, the format of grihastha life should be the dedication to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. In the Bhagavad Gita 6.1, it is said, anasrita karma palam karyam karma स संन्यासी च योगी च न निरात्मी न चात्रियः. One who is unattached to the fruit of his work and who works as the obligated is in the renounced order of life and is a true mystic, not he who likes no fire and perform no work. Whether one acts as a brahmachari, grahastha, vanaprastha or sannyasi, he must act only for the satisfaction of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vasudev, Krishna, the son of Vasudev. This should be the principle of everyone's life. Narada Muni has already described the principle of life of brahmachari, vanaprastha and sannyasi, and now he is describing how a grahastha should live. The basic principle is to satisfy the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The science of satisfying the Supreme Lord can be learned as described here. Sakshat Upashita Mahamunin. The word Mahamunin refers to great saintly person or devotees. Saintly persons are generally known as munis or thoughtful philosophers concerned with transcendental subject matters. And Mahamuni refers to those who are not only thoroughly studied the goal of life but who are actually engaged in satisfying the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vasudeva. These persons are known as devotees. Unless one associates with devotees, one cannot learn the science of Vasudeva Arpanam or dedicating one life to Vasudeva, Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. In India, the principles of this science was followed strictly. Even 50 years ago, I saw that in the villages of Bengal and suburbs of Calcutta, people engaged in hearing Srimad Bhagavatam daily. When all the activities ended, or at least in the evening before going to bed, everyone should hear the Bhagavatam. Bhagavata classes were held in every village and such people had the advantage of hearing Srimad Bhagavatam, which described everything about the aim of life, liberation or salvation. This will be clearly explained in the next verses. A grihastha must associate again and again with saintly person, and with great respect he must hear the nectar of the activities of Supreme Lord and his incarnation, as these activities are described in the Srimad Bhagavatam and other Puranas. Thus one should gradually become detached from affection for his wife and children, exactly like a man awakening from a dream. That is the point. You know, this is not my words, this is from Narada Muni. The Krishna conscious movement has been established to give grihasthas all over the world an opportunity to hear Srimad Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita specifically. The process are described in many ways. One is one of hearing and chanting Srinvata Swatata Krishna Punya Shravana Kirtanam. Everyone, especially the grihasthas who are muddhadi, ignorant about the goal of life, should be given opportunity to hear about Krishna. Simply by hearing, by attending lectures in different centers of the Krishna conscious movement, where topics of Krishna from Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam are discussed, they will be purified of their sinful inclination for constant indulgence in illicit sex, meat-eating, intoxication and gambling, which have all become prominent in modern days. Thus they can be raised to the status of light, Punya Shravana Kirtanam, simply by joining the Kirtan, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, and by hearing about Krishna from Bhagavad Gita, one must be purified. Especially if he also takes prasadam. This is going on in the Krishna conscious movement. Another specific description here is Srinvan Bhagavato Vichanam Avatara Katamritam. It is not that because one has finished Bhagavad Gita, he should not hear it again. This is another very important point. Someone always say, no, I read already. Very boring, I read already. No, I know. See, the word abhichanam is very important. We should hear again and again. There's no question of stopping. Even if one has read these topics many times, he should go on reading again and again, because Bhagavad Katha, the word spoken by Krishna and spoken by Krishna's devotee about Krishna, amritam, nectar. The more one drinks this amritam, the more he advances in his eternal life. The human form of life is meant for liberation, but unfortunately, due to the influence of Kali Yuga, every day the grihasthas are working hard like asses. Early in the morning, they rise and travel even 100 miles away to earn bread. Especially in the Western countries, I have seen that people awake at 5 o'clock to go to office and factories to earn their livelihood. People in Calcutta and Bombay also do this every day. They work very hard in the office or factory, and again they spend 3 or 4 hours in transportation returning home. Then they retire at 10 o'clock and again rise early in the morning to go to the offices and factories. This kind of hard labor is described in the Shastra as the life of pigs and stool eaters. Nayam deho deha bhajan nirloke kasta kama nahati he vidbhujam ye. Of all living entities who have accepted material bodies in this world, one who has been awarded this human form should not work hard day and night simply for sense gratification, which is available even for dogs and hogs that eat stool. One must find some time for hearing Srimad Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita. This is very culture. One should not hours at the most to earn his livelihood, and either in the afternoon or in the evening as the household, they should discuss with devotees to hear for the incarnation of Krishna and activities, and thus be gradually liberated from the clutches of Maya. However, instead of finding time to hear about Krishna, the householders, after working hard in office and factories, find time to go to a restaurant or a club where instead of hearing about Krishna and his activities, they are very much pleased to hear about the political activities of demons and non-devotees, and to enjoy sex, wine, women and meat in this way, waste their time. This is not grihastha life, but demonic life. Krishna conscious movement, however, which is centered all over the world, gives such fallen, condemned person an opportunity to hear about Krishna. In a dream, we form a society of friendship and love, and when we awaken, we see that it has ceased to exist. Similarly, one gross society, family and love are also a dream, and this dream will be over as soon as one dies. Therefore, whether one is dreaming in a subtle way or a gross way, these dreams are all false and temporary. One's real business is to understand that one is soul, aham brahmasmi, and that his activity should be therefore be different, then one can be happy. Brahma bhuta prasanatma na shoti na kanchati samaha sarveshu bhuteshu mad bhakti labhate param. When one is transcendentally situated, at one realizes the supreme Brahman and becomes fully joyful. He never laments nor desires to have anything. He is equally disposed to all living entities. In that stage, he attains pure devotional service unto me. One who is engaged in devotional service can very easily be liberated from the dream of materialistic life. To this point, this is what has been said by while working to earn his livelihood as much as necessary to maintain body and soul together, one is actually learned to live in human society unattached to family attached, although externally appearing very much attached. So he says this is how it's been prescribed by Narada Muni. An intelligent man in human society should make his own programs of activity very simple. If there are suggestions from his friends, children, parents, brothers, or anyone else, he should externally agree saying, yes, that is all right. But internally, he should be determined not to create a cumbersome life in which the purpose of life will not be fulfilled. Passionate life entangles someone, and then he becomes completely stuck. So again, we are trying to understand the symptom of how to do this. See, one should definitely associate with devotees as much as possible to hear. You know, this is a very important point. That's why Prabhupada spent so much time writing his books and giving it all to us, translating. Why? Because only by hearing, developing the hearing about Krishna, we can counteract these bad qualities. Once you become a devotee, you develop all the good qualities. And if you are a devotee and you're not developing the good qualities, then something is wrong. So therefore, we have to check. There's always check and balance in our heart. We, everybody have a heart and everybody have a mind. And if our mind is thinking in a passionate way, then my spiritual discipline is not very good. You follow this point. That means something is not wrong right in my heart. Why am I thinking in this negative way? Why am I always thinking in this bad consciousness? That means I have got a problem. I understand. That means I must change. And that means we have to come and associate with devotees. And by associating with devotees, then we will also develop all these things automatically. You follow this point. When you are in the association of devotees, you get also purified. Purification is very essential for the contamination of the mode of passion and ignorance. That's why you say it here, you see. There's no substitute for this, you know. That's why the shortcut is this. One must conquer the mode of passion and ignorance by developing the mode of goodness, and then one must become detached from the mode of goodness by promoting oneself to the platform of Sudha Sattva. All this can be automatically done if one engages in the service of the spiritual master with faith and devotion. And this way, one can conquer the influence of the modes of nature. This is the point. This is the underlying point. The underlying. So we have to take. And what is the instruction of the spiritual master? It's very clear. From this we can understand now we have to be very cautious in executing our spiritual duties by observing the rules and regulations and regularly chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. If we neglect doing this, we will eventually fall down. We must rise early in the morning, bath, attend Mangala Aarti, worship the deity, chant Hare Krishna Mantra, study the Vedic literature and follow all the rules prescribed by the Acharyas and spiritual masters. If we deviate from this process, we may fall down, even though we may be very highly advanced, as stated in the Bhagavad Gita. So, you see, this is our consciousness. There's always check and balance. Everybody can understand this. It is not difficult. And when you develop the good qualities, that goodness is there. I've already explained all the saintly qualities will come to you. And that means you know you are making progress. But you're developing the bad qualities, that means you are not making progress. That's dangerous, because then desire to associate devotees will never come in the heart. You're always trying to fall fine with the person who are going to help you, the devotees. And then when you fall fine with the very people who can save you, then where's the question of deliverance? Then everything is finished. See? So therefore it is very important that we, you know, understand this simple logic. If we carry on getting ourselves more implicated in the mode of passion and ignorance, then our progress will be checked. Very detrimental. That's why Prabhupada created the temple. So why? Devotees must stay near temple and they must regularly come to the temple. Not that they come once in a blue moon or once in a festival or once they like. No, Prabhu, I'm doing it at home. This whole thing is very difficult, very, very difficult. You see that just now Yudhishthira Maharaj said, the only way for householders to make advancement is to associate with devotees. You understand? That's the only hope. And if you find fault with that, then how you will not go? And when you don't go, then you will associate with the non-devotees. And when you associate with non-devotees, then you will all develop all the bad qualities. And what are the symptoms of bad qualities? I already explained. You know, all these dirty things in the heart will keep growing. So our duty now to understand this, you know, this knowledge is very important. Why Krishna is speaking? This knowledge. Without this knowledge, we cannot get to control our mind. Our mind can be defeated by intelligence. Superior intelligence means spiritual intelligence, not the mundane book, mundane material intelligence. That's useless. That only can teach you how to eat, sleep, mate, and defend. That animal also has got that. It's not difficult, as you can see for this verse, you know. The animal also very expert. See here? A desire to maintain body, wife, children is also observed in animal society. The animals have full intelligence to manage such affairs. If a human being is simply advanced in this respect, what is the difference between him and an animal? One should be very careful to understand that human life is attained after many, many births in the evolutionary process. A learned man who gives up the bodily concept of life, both gross and subtle, will be enlightened. will be by the enlightenment of spiritual knowledge become a prominent individual spirit soul as the Supreme Lord is also. Then you become happy. You know, it's not that you're so important to take care of wife, children, family. You know, this thing is very dangerous actually, you know, very, very dangerous. You can see here in the Bhagavatam it's explained. You know, that a person who try to do this is also taken to hell. Not that, you know, this is very important, I have to take care of the family. I'm not saying you don't take care of family, but that is secondary. The main thing is that you should always try to become Krishna conscious. And that is the main thing. You understand? That is the main thing. Let me get that verse out for you. I think it's in the beginning. Give me a minute. So it says in the 5:26, you know, a person who is, you know, yes, can see here, 5:26:10. A person who has set his body as his self works very hard day and night for money to maintain his own body and the bodies of his wife and children. While working to maintain himself and family, he may commit violence against other living entities. Such a person is forced to give up his body and his family at the time of death when he suffers the reaction of his envy of other creatures by being thrown into the hell called Kaurava. So it is not that you excuse, you know, I'm okay, I'm doing fine. And all these kind of concussions are all based on the mental plane and coming in contact with mode of passion. So a person should be constantly thinking how to love Krishna, how to become Krishna conscious, how to associate with devotees. This should be the proper understanding. So okay, I spoke at length. So I'm going to stop here, and any one of you has got a questions, I will unmute you. If you put your hand up, then they can all, you know, hear and we can answer your questions. Anybody has got questions? Let me know. Doesn't look like anybody has a question, huh? I can unmute you and you can ask the question. Yes? Right. Looks like, oh, there's one question. Oh, this is a previous question. Right, there's a question. I'm going to unmute Vijay Kishore. Yes.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Please ask my dandavas. Prabhu, so regarding the topic about associating with the devotees at the temple for household devotees, the main idea is to associate with devotees in the renounced order, either brahmacharis or sannyasis. So what if in a setup like here in Philippines, we don't have devotees in the renounced order? So no, everybody may feel that anyway, it's just grihastha devotees, so we can also practice at home or something like that.
No doubt, you know, you may be householder devotees, but you are doing a regular program. Mm-hmm. And you are congregating together and hearing Prabhupada's instruction. Follow.
Yes, sir.
Not necessary association mean only on the renounced association. Association mean to hear about Krishna. If you go to the renowned people and you learn how to smoke ganja, what's the use? You understand? Association
yes.
means here to strengthen our Krishna consciousness. So Prabhupada specifically set up these temples where there are householders, there's brahmachari, there's some places there may be more householders. But actually if you just follow the program strictly as laid out by the acharya, then you should have no problem. The main thing is to follow the instruction of the spiritual master, acharya upasanam. You understand?
Yes.
And you have to hear the classes, and when you hear the classes, you are associating, is it not?
Yes, sir.
So, you follow. That's why Prabhupada wanted all temples and all householders to stay near the temple, so that they can come and, you know, at least attend the program and hear Bhagavatam and hear Bhagavad Gita, chant together. This is very important. And plus, you see, association, you're also associating with other devotees. Like now, we have got this modern webinar thing and all. Correct?
Yes.
You're not hearing?
Yes, sir.
So, it's a question of whether you want or not. That is all. It's no question of, you know, what it is. It's a question of your desire to go. If in order to go, you do. You follow? Mm. Unless in the householders, the association, all of them are talking a mundane subject matter and not Krishna conscious, then that's a problem.
Mm.
You see, now by going to the temple and doing the program every day, even householders also get strength, is it not?
Yes, sir.
So, what is the problem? The problem is to follow acharya. That's the system. If you keep to the principle of listening to the acharyas, then everything becomes fine. When the acharya principle is neglected, then who can help? Nobody can help. Yes?
Yes, sir.
Spiritual master is this. It is explained here in this verse. Even you may be very expert in controlling your mind and your senses, it says in this verse. The mind is like an impetus horse that even persons who have regulated their senses and breath cannot control. Those in this world who try to tame the uncontrolled mind but who abandon the feet of the spiritual master encounter hundreds of obstacles in the cultivation of various distressful practices. Oh, unborn Lord, they are like merchants on a boat in an ocean who have failed to employ a henchman. So how you can be successful if you neglect the order of the spiritual master? Huh? This is not possible. Understand? Because as Krishna says, you know, and we know this verse, we always quote. It says here, O Lord, you resemble the shining sun. You are always ready to fulfill the desire of your devotees, and therefore you are known as Desire Trivancha Kalpataru. When acharyas completely take shelter under your lotus feet in order to cross the fierce ocean and sign, they leave behind on earth the method by which they cross. And because you are very merciful to your other devotees, you accept this method to help them. So Prabhupada is the acharya and is given as a system. Yes?
Yes, Prabhupada.
When you try to transgress that, then how you can be successful? How Krishna will accept? Huh? You understand? So by this light, Prabhupada gave the example, the child may say, this is pencil. He learned from his father, this is pencil. And if he repeats it pencil, then what's wrong with the message? It's pure, is it not?
Yes, please.
But if you are a householder and you are breaking principle and not following and not nothing, then be a headache, no? Yes?
Yes, sir.
You follow? Prabhupada used to say, even the householders, if they are practicing, they are also sannyasis. The consciousness. Yes?
Yes, sir.
Any other questions? can raise your hand. I can unmute you. Anybody has a question? All right, since none of you got a question, I wish you all a happy Deepavali. All glories to all of you. Carry on associating, and I'm sure by strictly following this program, every auspicious thing will come, and Krishna will very quickly manifest in your heart. As this verse we have always been showing you all of you all the time. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is so kind to the conditioned soul that if they call upon Him by speaking His holy name, even unintentionally or unwillingly, the Lord is inclined to destroy innumerable sinful reactions in their heart. Therefore, when a devotee has taken shelter of Lord's feet, chant the holy name of Krishna with genuine love, the Supreme Personality of Godhead can never give up the heart of such a devotee. One who has thus captured Supreme Lord within the heart is known as Bhagavad Pradhana, the most exalted devotee of the Lord. So that's all you need to do, chant and try to come temple, associate with devotees and try to, you know, get the impression of the deity in your heart, and everything would be first class. Yes? Can't hear well, it's noisy. It's still noisy? Okay then. Hare Krishna. Oh yes, no more question. Can you hear all right now? Can you hear okay now? Can you hear? Okay. All right then. Hare Krishna. All glories to Srila Prabhupada.